This is also the 23rd Sunday after Pentecost, and we continue with our opening acclamation on the top of page 2. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Sons in my womb, that they may become your husbands? Turn back. have my daughters go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. Even if I thought there was hope for me, even if I should have a husband tonight and bear sons, would you then wait until they were grown? Would you then refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, it has been far more bitter for me than for you, because the hand of the Lord has turned against me. Then they wept aloud again. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. So she said, "See, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Do not press me to leave you or to turn back from following you. Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. There will I be buried. May the Lord do this and so to me, and more as well, if even death parts me from you." Then Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, and she said no more to her. The word of the Lord.
Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
scribes came near and heard the Sadducees disputing with one another. And seeing that Jesus answered them well, he asked him, "Which commandment is first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.'" Then the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and besides him there is no other. And to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself, this is much more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." After that, no one dared to ask him any question. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. In this exchange with an earnest and well-meaning scribe, Jesus teaches the scribe and us not only what is the greatest commandment, but what is the overarching purpose of every commandment. So then, how would you answer that scribe's question? Which commandment is first of all? Out of the minimum 10 we are encouraged to memorize as children, which one would you pick as our Judeo-Christian prime directive? Hesitant though one might be to risk contradicting Jesus and Paul for that matter, what would you say? Which of them do you think is the first? And here we are not talking only about the numerical order in which the Old Testament states them. Which of them is the greatest? But then again, is it even valid to declare one greater than the others? Are they not all equally great? Or might this be negotiable according to different personalities or in accord with specific situations or questions of whose ox got gored? Could it be that different commandments speak to different people, or that different people might need different commandments out of all we've been given to count for, or to stand in for, all of them? And what is the motivation for the scribe's question? What is Jesus getting at in his terse reply to the curious scribe? The Decalogue offers a kind of built-in answer to the scribe's question. The first, and by implication greatest, commandment is given straightforwardly to us by God in Exodus chapter 20. "You shall have no other gods before me." This is the first of the Ten Commandments numerically, but there is nothing in it about loving God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, as Jesus mentions in today's reading from Mark. This commandment, importantly but simply, acknowledges that God is God, and there is no other. That is where it all begins. But does it end there? Jesus, in his reply to that scribe, implies that it doesn't. Jesus doesn't reference the Ten Commandments. Rather, he cites the opening of a passage the Jews call the Shema from Deuteronomy chapter 6. Specifically, he quotes verse 5, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your might. But he adds to it, with all your mind. There is something greater, more primal, at stake than rote repetition, simple memorization, or wooden application of law inscribed on tablets. Something greater than even pious acknowledgement of the greatness of God. That something greater is love. This particular scribe, unlike most others Jesus comes in contact with, is beginning to catch glimpses of that. He's not far from love, not far anyway from an intellectual grasp of its ultimate importance. And so Jesus says to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." The scribe doesn't ask after a second greatest commandment. Jesus volunteers that. You shall love your neighbor as yourself, referencing Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18. Perhaps Jesus is making the point that the two are really one commandment. There is only one greatest commandment. Love God. Or perhaps he's making a larger, more nuanced point. Out of this primal love of God will flow forth inevitably love of neighbor as oneself. The two are inseparably bound. Jesus' reply, as indicated earlier, a citation from Deuteronomy 6, but this first half of the equation really is the strongest, greatest, or however you want to put it. Love God with everything you've got, heart, soul, mind, and strength, and everything else that really matters, follows from it. How do you know what you're loving is the real God and not a self-serving fabrication? Love of the real God, as opposed to some self-serving idol or other, leads to love of neighbor as oneself. And the scribe hastens to agree. He elaborates by pointing out that this love of God leading to love of the neighbor is more important than religious ritual, all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices, which is to say, from a scribe's perspective, more important than anything. And Jesus tells this scribe, this is interesting, in that the scribes usually present as Jesus' enemies, but Jesus tells this scribe that he is not far from the kingdom of God. Now, some commentators say, rather dismissively, that this is the equivalent of Jesus saying, "Jealous, been outside," or "close, but no cigar." But really, it sounds like a compliment. In the first place, Jesus, the text tells us, acknowledges that the scribe answered wisely. And not far from the kingdom of God is as close as any of us can hope to get. And in verses immediately following these, Jesus minces no words in his harsh criticism of scribes. This scribe is not far from the kingdom of God. God's kingdom is drawing near. And the scribe's answers reveals that he belongs to it. The kingdom is drawing near. The scribe's understanding of love's preference over law is what draws him near. Love pairs the Ten Commandments down to two, or really one, as we've already said. Does this therefore reduce the significance of the Ten Commandments, or even do away with them? Not really. Commandments 10, 2 are not God? 10 commandments? 2 commandments? How many do we need? What do we have in the backlog? We were encouraged to memorize as kids a list of instructions on how to climb up on a mountain. Which of them is most important? Or are they all equally important? Elsewhere in the New Testament, in Romans chapter 13, verses 8 through 10, Paul makes a claim similar to the implication of Jesus regarding love being necessary to fulfill the law of God. It should be said that this perspective of Paul precedes the written Gospels by a decade or two. That's what we are getting in Paul and in Jesus' conversation with the scribe, is teaching that has been embedded in the church from its earliest days. What we are getting in Jesus' interaction with the scribe is as close to Christianity 101 as we're going to get. Love. Love God. Love your neighbor as yourself. Oh no, no one anything, Paul says in that Romans 13 passage, except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. He goes on to imply that obedience to this directive takes precedence over all the others, indeed encompasses all the others. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word, love your neighbor as yourself. No greatest commandment, no first commandment, but one. One word. Paul is going even further than Jesus. Paul is condensing everything to love your neighbor as yourself, the one commandment. So where do we go with this? What must be our answer to that question? Which commandment is first of all? The commandment which is the first of all is not even one of the Big Ten, but it is the source and focus and purpose of all commandments. It is what gives all the commandments their meaning. In fact, without it, they have no meaning. They're just words engraved on a stone.
Summed up
in this one word, love, for your neighbor and yourself. This is how we know God and how we know that we know God, through love of neighbor as ourselves. Life with God does not end with knowing that. It begins there. The end is found in going forth and doing. So shall we?
Brian. pray for those who are celebrating a birthday this week, especially Dorothy Lynn and Eula Bousfield. Are there others? Let us pray for our own needs and for those of others.
And a prayer for an end to racial prejudice. One God in three persons, creator of one human species in many hues. All who pray to you are descendants of Adam and Eve, all members of one race called humans. Forgive the blindness that causes our eyes to notice and magnify those things we regard as different from ourselves and others. Teach us to see clearly that we, your children, are far more alike than we are different. Help us to put aside the racial prejudices embedded within us, and to see within every person the child of God you created, our sister or brother, destined for glory. In the name of the one who died for all persons of all colors, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by all we have done, and by all we have left undone. We have not done what you have done.
Singers in the parish choir. We need some tenors and altos if you're interested in singing. Also, Paul will convey you, our children will be rehearsing for that. As you know, the children really enjoy singing for lessons and carols, and they're a big hit. They really enjoy singing with the orchestra. So if you have school-age children, be watching for Paul to give you information as to how we rehearse for that. Thank you.
We got choir, too.
Choir starts back, when I was going to say that. Choir starts back on November the 11th. That's where I need the tenors and altos, and anybody, by the way, in the narthex. We'll rehearse in the narthex so we can spread out some more. And those rehearsals would just be to prepare for lessons and carols. So if you can't make a Sunday morning commitment, but you just want to sing for lessons and carols, please come on November the 11th.
Thanks, Dan. You'll see a little blurb down there at the bottom of your announcements about buy one, give one, Thanksgiving turkey project that we are sponsoring through Bellwether Farm as a diocese. So if you'd like to do that, you can visit that website, the Bellwether Farm website, to give. Please also remember Lincoln School in your stewardship. They need fat crayons for the little ones. They need leggings and sweatpants. Sometimes the only showers that these kids get is over at the school, and they do their laundry for them too, so they need something to wear while they're cleaning them up. They could use peanut butter and jelly, ramen noodles, fruit cups, all that kind of stuff. Just basic, simple stuff that they can eat without having necessarily to warm it up, or simply warm it up in a microwave. So if you can keep those in your thoughts and prayers and stewardship, truly be appreciated. Walk in love, as Christ loved us, and bring offerings and come into his courts.
Thank you.
by placing your hands on your chest like this, and I'll just make a small sign of the cross on your forehead. I want to make sure you feel welcome and invited to participate in the sacrament. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thy name. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
When you return to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give you thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Calling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify
Thank you.
Please join me in saying the prayer for spiritual communion on the bottom of page 10. In union, O Lord, with your faithful people at every altar of your church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, I desire to offer to you praise and thanksgiving. I remember your death, Lord Christ. I proclaim your resurrection. I await your coming in glory. Since I cannot receive you today in the sacrament of your body and blood, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. Cleanse and strengthen me with your grace, Lord Jesus, and let me never be separated from you. May I live in you, and you in me, in this life, and in the life to come. Amen. And our post-communion prayer. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spirit and food in the sacrament of his body. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty,